Hello everyone and welcome back to Around the World in 80 Planes and Next Plane 11. For this flight I'm in the B1B by domhenry and we are flying from Anchorage to Juneau in Alaska. Been in Alaska for quite a while now, but yep, it's a big state. And this is what it looks like. The B1B is this freeware and pretty good for that. And outside it looks like this, which is nice. Of course the B1B is always nice. And we're gonna have a little bit of flaps. Just wanted to check whether those work properly. Oh, maybe that isn't enough of a notch. Okay. All right. Well, we are continuing on with the Apollo 13 audio. And so without further ado, just waiting for it to start. There we go. All right, throttle up. Good. Very good. Wing sweep is manual right now. I'm going faster than I ought to.
That's correct. Go to page 1-9 and on panel 100, skip the first four. We want IMU power off. Over. Okay, skip the next one. We want numerical.
All right, very good. It's reacting smoothly. Oh, well, I let go of the joystick there. I'll trim first.
Alright. Okay, on panel 101, skip the first three. We want urine dump to off and wastewater dump to off. Over.
Got it.
Okay, on panel 122.
Seems to take a lot of trim.
Condition lamps.
I keep trimming and it's not quite doing very much.
Okay, panel 162, no change. Panel 163, no change. Now, and
okay, there we go.
Panel 201, food warm.
Well, we're basically heading in the right direction. It won't be a very long flight. But I said that last time, it ended up being an hour because we had to circle around a bit.
Okay.
So, leaving Anchorage.
The first one is S-band FM transmitter, DSE group 1 open. Over.
I'm just gonna assume I have a special dispensation for going fast.
Main A and main B, and that's two breakers, both open.
Flight bus main A, flight bus main B.
Okay, that's correct. The last change is CTE. Both open. Over.
Could you say that again?
Affirmative. Central timing equipment. CTE. Both open. Over.
Oh. Okay. CTE 2. Open.
Affirmative. And that's all the changes on page 1-9.
Dump to off, wait, C2O dump to off.
that's correct, Jack. Let's go to page 1-10. And on panel 226.
I'm just playing around with the wing sweep a bit here. So I had tried the B1B before, but that was with the experimental flight model on, and that did not work very well, but now it's flying properly.
Okay, satisfactory, Jack. You ready for panel 226?
Let's go.
Okay, on panel 226, we want all open except. So change the word close to open. And then scratch out the next three lines, because we want them open too. Over.
Okay, all open except, and you're going to give me the ones that you want open.
Right, I'll give you the opens now. We want lighting, flood main A, main B, and flight slash post landing closed.
Well, the first scenery isn't too bad, at least. Not a whole lot of clouds this time, still real-world weather. Okay, I'm gonna turn on the afterburner.
There's
a pause there. Okay. We've drifted off from where I wanted to go. Manually doing the wing sweep does make it a little bit jerky. It's behaving well. Let's see, we're at Mach 1.3 now. Mach 1.35 actually, which is technically faster than it's supposed to be able to go. So maybe we should throttle down again. I'll take it out of afterburner.
Okay, I'm ready to go.
Yeah, Econ caught me. I said that wrong. We want you to change the word closed to open.
Man, Capcoms, make sure you're reading it right. It is a beautiful plane.
Roger, and on panel 275, we want all the circuit breakers open, no exceptions. Over.
Panel 275, all open, no exceptions.
Okay, and that's all for page 1-10. You want to read any of that back? I think you've got it all.
No, I think I've got it all.
Okay, let's go to page 1-11. On panel 276, no change. On panel 278, we want all circuit breakers open, no exceptions. Over.
Panel 278, all open.
Roger. Now we'll skip all the way down to panel 306, where we want the mission timer to stop and the event timer to stop. Over.
Okay, panel 306, mission timer stop, event timer stop.
Okay, and those are all the changes on 1-11, Jack. Page 1-12, panel 325.
Let me get my little plug-in active. Oh, that's pretty low frame rates considering there's not a whole heck of a lot going on right now. No, not that many clouds. Interesting. Might need to give my computer a restart or something.
Those are the last changes on 1-12. Let's go to 1-13.
Okay, ready to copy.
Okay, go down to panel 380. O2 demand reg valve to off and suit circuit return valve pulled to open. Over.
Of course, another factor that could be affecting frame rates is the fact that I've got a whole bunch of stuff open right now. Well, full disclosure, I've got Blender, Photoshop, Substance Painter, Unity, and my browser, and of course, right now it's Sony Vegas playing the audio from Apollo 13. Yeah. Not the best planning ever. I have a bad tendency to just keep things open just in case I want to work on something. We got some bad scenery here. Bit dark in here. We're still past Mach 1, but only Mach 1.15 now, without the afterburner. But we are sort of super cruising. To be clear, that's Deke Slayton, the head of crewed space flight.
Set up. Okay, I'm gonna go get the switch configuration.
by Craig Foreman on Apollo 8.
Okay.
Sorry about that.
Houston, go ahead.
Well, there's a glacier starting a river.
Okay, Jim, we're still gathering our thoughts on the MCC, but some of the considerations go like this. Fido tells us that we can do that.
Well, maybe not starting a river. I don't know. Well, definitely flowing into a river. Yep. Pretty much straight out into the bay. Well, I say bay, that's actually the Gulf of Alaska.
We're happy with the PTC mode that you're in now, and although we are working up an AGS PTC mode to use after the mid-course correction, we kind of like you to stay in this PTC for a while because it's doing good.
This glacier below us, that's the Goodwin Glacier, maybe? And then the one in front of us, possibly the Miles Glacier. And then this is Miles Lake. Yeah, that makes sense. So Miles Lake, Miles Glacier. Oh, it's looking a bit better around here. Much better continuity in the scenery.
This is Apollo Control. We're at the
anticipating the start of the change of shift press conference within the next few moments in the Building 1 auditorium, the main auditorium.
We're right about here. So not many landmarks.
The participants will be the
visible.
Maroon Team Flight Director Milton Wendler and Retro Fire Officer from that team, Tom Weichel. Changes in procedure, the spacecraft power-up and checklist being passed up by Joe Kerwin to the crew. We've had no biomedical telemetry in the last several hours from the crew, and there's been no report of any medication having been taken by the crew of Apollo 13. Distance now from Earth, 182,390 nautical miles. Velocity, 3,920 feet per second. Total spacecraft weight, 87,942 pounds. At 92 hours, 54 minutes. On the lapse time, and standing by, this is Apollo Control. Aquarius, Houston, over.
Go ahead, Houston.
Fred, just wanted to let you know in advance that we're coming up on the red line CO2 value for the secondary canister, and we expect to get there in something like a half hour, at which time we'll be asking you to switch over to the command module canisters. I have the rest of that procedure ready, and I just wanted to warn you a little bit in advance. Over.
Okay. And I got a question for you, Joe.
Go ahead.
I don't know why it's so... Reluctance.
Okay, I'm stupid.
Yes, this point.
I'm not quite sure what you're getting at.
Okay,
we need some place to put the urine.
It sounds to me as if the suggested receptacle is perfectly satisfactory. Do you think you can use it in its present configuration?
Oh yeah, we got all the interconnect hookups we need, but I wasn't sure if that gadget was devised solely with the 160 environment in mind, and whether it might leak.
I'll
have them verify that.
The urine receptacle is the LEM one, which was really only meant to be used on the lunar surface. Well, maybe not, but they wanted to make sure whether it was or not. Quite an expanse of white.
And,
Columbus Glacier. And that's this huge line of white here. Instruments disagreeing on how much CO2 there is. Well, that's a good look right there. I don't know what this mountain is, but don't have a name on it on the map. Wow, nice bit of green right here in the midst of the sea of white. Caught between all these glaciers rushing. Look at that. A whirlpool of glaciers. Malaspina Glacier, that's that. Malaspina Glacier. A little bit of green here.
And as a first step, I'd like to know whether you've inserted the commander's red hose into the second canister bag.
Okay, yep, sure enough. The commander's red hose is inserted into the canister bag.
Okay, Fred, the next thing I'd like you to do is to take some more gray tape and tape over half the outlet area of each of the blue nozzles, the commanders and the LFPs. The reason we're doing this is we're going to be running this loop through the secondary LIOH canister hole with the canister removed, and we don't have the flow restriction we need to keep the separator from overspeeding. That's half of the commander's blue hose and half of the LMP's blue hose, the outlet hoses.
Oh, okay. I'll tape over half of each of the outlets. Stand by.
Okay.
Okay.
This is the Hubbard Glacier pouring out here. And in front of us is Tongass National Forest. Having a ball. Making new procedures, and I like that. Saturday or Sunday at the latest.
Saturday or Sunday.
And you hear the reaction. At the very latest. That's a great little bit. Of course, Saturday and Sunday would be too late for any procedures, I guess. The pressure suits being very important to this whole CO2 procedure that they've been going through, so that's why the news people need a briefing on them.
Oop.
Sound from outside. They don't know whether the urine capture device will leak or not, but if you need it, use it. Oh, that could go badly. I think I should start descent now. We are going pretty fast. And last time I overshot by quite, I mean, we had to loop around a whole lot. Of course, this I think has air brakes, so.
Secondary cartridge out. We're back on prep right now.
Okay, Jack, the next step is to place the command module canisters with the hoses attached in a suitable location to permit the bottom of the canister to be exposed to free airflow and tape them in place. Ideally, well, it doesn't matter. Just pick out your own spot.
Well, it descends pretty effectively. Uh-oh, comms are getting bad again.
Jack Houston, the comm got real noisy there, and I didn't copy that.
Okay, Joe, how do you read now?
Okay, that's real good, Jack. Go ahead.
Okay, the canisters are situated as you would like, with the bottom of the canister exposed to free air.
Okay.
The position of the LMP's canister. The LMP's canister is sitting on the ECS panel now, and the CDR's canister is positioned up in the tunnel.
Okay, real fine, Jack. The next step is to physically separate both blue hoses a good distance away from the canister so that we don't short-circuit the flow, and tape them in place, and the ideal location for them would be up in the tunnel so as to get some flow into the command module. Over.
Both hoses in the, up into the command module?
Oh, you can use your judgment on that, Jack. We'd like at least one, and the recommendation that I got was to put them both up in the tunnel. Okay, Jack, that sounds satisfactory. The next steps are suit loop configuration steps. And the first one is to place the suit diverter valve to the pull egress position.
Okay, suit diverter valve to pull egress.
That's affirmative. Okay, the next step is cabin gas return to egress. Over.
This is Apollo Control. The briefing on the Apollo suit should begin momentarily in the main auditorium of the Houston News Center. Bruce Ferguson of ILC Industries.
Gas return to egress, over. Correct.
Okay, that's done.
Okay, next, suit circuit relief to close. Over.
That's not. Oh, there we go.
Roger.
Still not there yet. Juneau is basically where it says approach to the map is sort of covering. It's not quite there yet. Oh, there's some bad scenery patches. Gosh darn it.
Roger, Jack. That completes that procedure, and the next thing I've got for you is a procedure for going back into the... module and powering up the main buses temporarily using the bus tie switches. We want to do this for two reasons. First of all, we want to absolutely verify that there are no loads on the main buses, that we've got everything off and that the buses look good. And the second thing we want to do is to power the main buses with the bus tie motor switches and then depower them by pulling the circuit breakers, leaving the main bus tie switches in the on position just to assure that they'll be there when we need them, whether the batteries get cold or not. Over. Jack, satisfactory. Did you copy my my rationale for the main bus power up?
Yeah, I did. You want to power up both buses with the bus side motor switches. First of all, to see that there are no loads on the buses, and second, and then depower the buses by pulling the circuit breakers to ensure that the motor switches don't.
That's correct, Jack. Are you ready to copy the procedure?
Okay,
as the first step, I have
a little bit of immersion braking right there.
The basic configuration that we gave you. And it's two more circuit breakers that we want open. On panel 225, are you ready to write that down, over?
All I want is the beautiful scenery to be here. Why must it be this way?
Nope,
we're getting a little bit diverted here. Okay, continuing descent.
So that you can read out your volts and amps. Next step on panel 250, we want circuit breaker bat A power entry and post landing and bat B power entry and post landing closed. Over.
Landing closed. Bat B,
primitive. And at that point, we'd like you to check the bat bus voltages on both bat buses to make sure we don't have any shorts, over.
Okay, there we go. There's Juneau International.
We want you to leave the main bus tie switches in the on position and pull the circuit breakers out in the reverse order that we had you close them. Over, and do you want me to read them up individually?
Go.
We'll wait to hear
from you. Gosh darn it, map. Oh, there it is. It's in yellow. Okay.
We are in exactly that configuration with one exception, and that is
Roger, Jack. Copy that on panel 382. You've left the H2O accumulator valves in the off position, and we concur.
Okay, and there's one other thing that I don't know whether you're aware of. We have no lithium hydroxide canisters in panel 2.
Okay, Jack, we copy that. That's correct, and I'll add that to our basic checklist so that we won't forget it.
Okay, we'll find Joe, and I'm on my way back into the command
bus. Good deal.
Okay, air brakes. Okay, retrimming.
Aquarius, Houston, over.
Go ahead.
Okay, Fred, we recommend that you push your master alarm circuit breaker in so you'll have audio and visual on that. And also, we medical types are getting the feel left out down here, and we'd like you to give us biomed either position if you're plugged in for it, and we'll see whether it affects the voice or not.
Okay, Houston, Aquarius, going down towards the backup base plan.
Aquarius, Houston, reaching now, satisfactory.
Okay, and I'm plugged in.
Okay, thank you very much, Fred.
It's actually a good deal. That little power pack heats up and helps warm.
Roger that.
The power pack heats up and it keeps him warm. Okay, I should probably get into the cockpit now. Gear down. Well, let's take a quick look.
That's correct. We've got all the breakers to the phone here.
All right. Oh, somewhere in front of us is a runway.
Okay, I'll just let me know how's our litho set up.
I think there's a hill in front of it. I see it now.
We are reading 0.2 on our CO2 sensor, and we're all delighted. It seems to be working fine.
Yeah, there it is. Can't really see the pappy lights like this. Okay. Oh, there we go.
Powering the command module main bus off the limb. And it's something that we feel is going to come in real handy later on for such things as topping off the command module entry batteries. And
okay.
Also possibly for doing some preheating and preliminary powering up of the command module before we get rid of the limb. We'll have that for you in probably 10 or 15 minutes.
Okay,
Joe.
Sounds good.
Let it quit.
Roger.
That mountain, though.
Aquarius, Houston.
Go ahead.
Okay, Fred, our procedure generating mill has generated another very short one for you here. It's a procedure for getting an onboard readout. Okay.
We're a bit heavy.
Okay, Fred, this is a procedure for getting a readout of the descent propellant tank temps. It's no big problem, but
okay.
The descent stage is probably cooling.
That wasn't good. Crazy hill in front of the airport. I mean, who does that, really? I think we were carrying too much fuel and it was pretty darn heavy coming down. Anyway, nothing broken. Jeez, the quality of my flights. Can't blame the experimental flight model on this one, but anyway, I'm gonna pause the Apollo audio right there, and we'll pick that up next time. And next time we'll be flying finally somewhere other than Alaska. It'll be Prince Rupert in British Columbia, Canada. So with that, I'll say thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed this flight. If you did, please do press like. If you have any comments or suggestions, please leave them in the comment section below. And I'll see you next time.